Well, it's good to see all of you this morning. I'm excited about the book of Zechariah, and I hope, as I said before, that it's an encouragement to us as we work through it. So today, what I'd like to do is just to introduce the book, and Lord willing, to get through the first six verses by way of introduction, so we set the table for the rest of our study as we work through the next several chapters, which will be a variety of visions which Zechariah sees, which have prophetic import for the nation of Israel, as well as even for us today, because many of them look forward beyond the time of Christ to a future day when Christ would return and be installed as king and priest. And so I trust it'll be an encouragement to us as we work through that. Well, I don't know if you've ever had an instance in your life where you were told that you had to do something and you deliberately did the opposite with disastrous consequences. This often probably particularly happens when we're younger as children, but sometimes probably even in our jobs or in our families, we're given advice or told to do something, we do something else, and then disaster ensues. And I remember this vividly because this happened in a very dramatic way when I was younger, about the age of 10. We were getting ready to go out for the evening. It was a Saturday evening, and we lived out in the country, so it was a big deal if we went to the city, and we would do our grocery shopping, maybe go out to eat, do some several things, and come back. And so all of us kids were ready to go, kind of dressed up a little bit, ready to go on our trip. And so my parents had told me just to stay put in the living room while everyone else was getting ready. But I thought it would be a better idea to get my bike out and start riding around. So that's what I did. And they had explicitly said, you know, don't ride your bike, just stay in the living room. Well, so I'm riding my bike, and I don't know if guilt feelings were plaguing my mind or something, but I'm coming back, crossing the road right in front of my house, and was struck by a car. So it was a very dramatic thing, obviously. My parents, I can just imagine now as a parent, what they were thinking as they're up in their room and they hear the screeching tires and all of that. And so the Lord was gracious, and my injuries were minimal other than a broken pinky, and I think I tore an earlobe or something, but it obviously could have been much worse. But that made me realize in a dramatic way that, hey, when your parents tell you to do something, you probably should pay attention. Well, Zechariah opens his prophecy in much the same way, in something of a veiled, prophetic, I told you so, reminder to God's people that they need to pay attention, to listen up, and to pay attention to what God is saying. And so these first six verses, I hope, can sink into our minds a little bit this morning to remind us that when God says something, we need to be paying attention. We live in a very distracted age, don't we? It's hard sometimes to concentrate more than 2 minutes on any given task, especially when you're on the internet and you think, oh, I need to search something here or there, and we get distracted very easily. But Zechariah is calling us to recenter and refocus ourselves on paying attention and listening to the word of the Lord. So let's do that this morning. I want to read the first six verses, and you have a handout, I hope. Most of you were able to get that, and I have a translation there that I'll read, and you can follow along with that or with any other version that you've brought this morning. So it begins this way. In the eighth month, in the second year of Darius, the word of the Lord came to Zechariah, the prophet, son of Berechiah, son of Iddo, saying, the Lord was furious with your fathers. Literally, this means he was angry with anger. He was furious, very emotionally disturbed. Therefore, say to them, thus says the Lord of hosts, turn back to me, declares the Lord of hosts, and I will turn back to you, says the Lord of hosts. Do not be like your fathers, to whom the former prophets proclaimed, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, turn back from your evil ways and from your evil deeds, but they neither listened nor paid attention to me, says the Lord of hosts. Your fathers, where are they now? And the prophets, do they live forever? Indeed, my words and my statutes, which I commanded my servants, the prophets, did they not overtake your fathers? So they turned back and said, just as the Lord of hosts purposed to do to us, according to our ways and according to our deeds, so he has done with us. Now, we may read through this and think, I'm not sure that there's much devotionally to take out of this passage, but I think it is helpful to orient ourselves to what the Lord was saying in this context, in this day and place, and how it can also be applied in our day. All right, so Zechariah begins this book, and he begins with a date formula. You'll remember that a couple of weeks ago, I gave an overview of this book as a whole as we were drawing down to a close in our study of the minor prophets, and we looked at Zechariah several weeks ago, and then we looked at Malachi last week. And so if you recall some of that material, Zechariah, as far as where he's situated, is one of the three prophets who comes to Judah after the exile. So this is in the 500s BC, 520 to be exact. Zechariah comes on the scene. His first oracle that he dates here in verse 1 is actually 6 weeks before the last oracle which Haggai gives. So Haggai and Zechariah are put next to each other, and chronologically they overlap. So Zechariah prophesies right in the middle of Haggai's four oracles. And so it's the end of October, early November, 520 BC when Zechariah comes. This is the only date formula which doesn't give a day, a specific day. And so we're not sure why that's the case. All the other formulas, both in Haggai and in Zechariah, give the day. It may be simply that Zechariah is saying, everyone should know, should be able to figure out, Haggai is ministering, and so I'm in the middle of Haggai's prophecy. And so that's the only precision that we really get. So Zechariah comes on the scene here in late October, early November, 520 BC, and he has a message. It says here in verse 1 that the word of the Lord comes to him. So I want to talk about this in two ways this morning. I want to talk first about who Zechariah is. Who is this guy, and why is his family background perhaps significant? And then secondly, what does it mean that the word of the Lord comes to him? What does this specific formula suggest about what's going on? All right, so let's first talk about Zechariah the man. And I got a black marker this morning for Pam Mannix. Thank you very much, so you can see. All right, so Zechariah is a prophet who comes on the scene here. He's one of this triad, this triumvirate, if you will, of post-exilic prophets, Haggai, Zechariah, Malachi. Zechariah comes on the scene in 520 BC, and he gives us a bit of a genealogy of his predecessors. Now, I would suggest that this is important, and let me tell you some of the reasons for this. Outside of, if you look at all the minor prophets, if we were to do a quick study of the introductory verse of every minor prophet, we would find that there are two of the minor prophets that give detailed genealogies. That is, either back more than one generation or any sort of family information at all. There are several that don't even give any family information. So the two that give the most are Zephaniah and Zechariah. Zephaniah gives the most. And the reason is that he can trace his lineage back to Hezekiah. If you remember that, he was part of the royal line. So he was a prophet from the kingly family, from the royal family. Zechariah is the second of those two who gives us more than simply one generation. In fact, he gives us two generations, Berechiah and Iddo. And the reason that he does so, as we'll see in a moment, is because he is of a priestly line. So Zephaniah is a prophet who's of the royal line. Zechariah is a prophet who's of the priestly line. All right, so what I'd like to do is just start listing some things that we notice about Zechariah. This is kind of an informal Bible study that we like to have as we go through these sections. So is there anything that you notice about verse 1? There's not much, but what few clues can we glean from here about who Zechariah is? Anyone? Okay, so he's the son of Berechiah. Okay. Probably none of us really know who Berechiah is, so that doesn't give us a whole lot of information. Anything else?
Prophet.
Okay, yep, he's a prophet. Okay. And who's the other genealogical forebear that he gives us, or the
grandson of Iddo?
Okay, so he's the grandson of Iddo. Now, it's probably not a name that we would use for our own children, Iddo, but it was a popular name in Israel. And in fact, if you read through Kings and Chronicles, the history of Israel that's recorded in there often names certain sources, and if you're familiar, it says this phrase again and again, are the deeds not written in the book of the kings of Judah and so on? And sometimes it refers to the book of the prophet Iddo. Okay, that's a different Iddo. Our Iddo is a post-exilic person, and so we want to understand a little bit about who he is. So to do that, let's go back to the book of Ezra and Nehemiah. We will be triangulating a lot with Ezra and Nehemiah because that helps us to set the context for what's going on. Ezra 5 and verse 1, if you can turn to Ezra 5, 1, and then we'll look at a verse in chapter 6, verse 14. So Ezra 5, 1. Can I have someone read this? Anybody be willing to do that?
Then the prophet Haggai, Zechariah, son of Iddo, prophesied to the Jews who were in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel who was over them.
Okay, so this tells us a little bit more maybe about Zechariah, but again, the clues are pretty sparse, but can anyone just shout out maybe anything additional information that you can glean from this verse about who Zechariah is?
Prophesied at the same time as Haggai.
Okay, right. So something that we know from the date formula, but it's reinforced here, that he's a contemporary of Haggai. Even we might say a colleague of Haggai because they're both prophets who are coming to prophesy. Okay, so that helps us to orient that, again, Zechariah is in the post-exilic period. All right, what does it say here about his family relationship?
Calls him the son of
Iddo. So is this a conflict from Zechariah 1:1? Some would say, yeah, that, you know, either Ezra got it wrong or the prophet got it wrong, or we're dealing with two different people. So what's the solution to this? Ben, do you have an idea?
It's Israel, they always mention the son of this, just like Jesus is the son of David. It doesn't mean it was actually his father. It's
okay.
Very, very common to just name a grandson, someone important. It could be several genealogies back. It doesn't even have to just be a grandson. A Levitical name is just someone that they could, people at the time would know.
Okay.
He's a descendant.
Yeah, he's a descendant. And that is an important thing to remember. If you read the Gospel account of Matthew, Jesus' birth, Joseph is even called a son of David. So let me explain it this way. It's a common idiom. Our last names, you know, mean something. You know, if the last name is Johnson, at some point in your genealogy, there was probably a John who had a son, and that's how you got the last name. Well, in Israel, they would often use the Hebrew word Ben as meaning a son, Ben of something. And this equals son of. So really all this is saying is Zechariah ben Iddo, meaning he's a descendant of Iddo. And from Ezra's perspective, Iddo is the key forefather. He's the key family in the family line. And so Ezra wants to point back to Iddo as a key person. All right, so why is Iddo important? It could take us a lot of time to study this, but let me just mention that chapter 6 and verse 14 says basically the same thing, that Haggai and Zechariah, the son of Iddo, were constructing, were prophesying in that day. Iddo was one of the priestly families that came back from Babylon. Okay, so this is why this is important. If we took the time to really trace out Iddo and study him, we would realize he came back from Babylon with Zerubbabel, and he's mentioned in several of those genealogies that we often skip because we're just, the names don't mean a lot to us realistically. But if we were to study the genealogies, he's one of the significant priestly families. He returns from Babylon with Zerubbabel, and so Zechariah is part of this family. So when we read Zechariah 1:1, if we go back there, well, let me first, there's one other passage. I'm not sure if this gives any additional light, but it's Nehemiah chapter 12 and verse 16. You can just note that there, but in Nehemiah 12, 16, actually, if you go up to verse 12, it says, in the days of Joiakim were priests, heads of fathers' houses, and then he begins to list them. Verse 16, of Iddo, Zechariah. Okay, so in other words, Iddo was important enough to make it into this genealogy. These genealogies are very selective, and so Iddo has some importance in the post-exilic community. He's one of the key priestly families. They return with Zerubbabel back to Judah, to Jerusalem. All right, so let's go back to the book of Zechariah. So with this in mind, when Zechariah comes on the scene and he gives us his genealogy, and then he describes himself by saying he is what? A prophet. Now, Zechariah could have said the priest or the Levite, but he says here a prophet. So what's the significance of that? Zechariah is coming, he's ministering, he's prophesying to the people. When he gives his genealogy, they're going to think priestly family. So if you're an Israelite, sometimes it's good to try to imagine we're there and we're listening and hearing this go on. Zechariah comes to prophesy. You know his family background, that he's part of the key priestly families. What significance is that going to have as you listen to his message? What do you think? Any ideas? Would it color your perception of what he's saying, perhaps, in any different way?
Absolutely.
How so?
Yeah, it's relevant to that. It carries more clout, because if he's of a priestly genealogy, then them being of their descent, it's from their neighborhood, I guess you could say. It's, well, he's of our kind, then we're going to listen. It's not like it's just some Gentile or
right.
some Greek coming through and saying, hey, this is my prophecy. It's their people, so
okay.
Well, it's going to carry much more clout. So
okay, right. So it's part of the families that are really significant for
Absolutely.
Them, right? Because the priests are to be the spiritual leaders. They're the ones who are to be teaching the law. So Zechariah comes from within those circles, and that carries a lot of clout. All right, any other thoughts about that?
Well, we've just been through a time where there were a lot of prophets who were really false. That's how they ended up in Babylon, partially.
Right.
So.
Okay. Right, so there's a hope here, I think, an expectation that Zechariah is going to be a true prophet because he's coming from this priestly perspective that they're the ones, if anyone is, that should be the ones telling them how rightly to worship God. If they're going to do it right, the priest should be the one to help them with that. Okay, good. Any other thoughts? All right, well, if we kind of put all this together, I think Zechariah is coming on the scene as a prophet, knowing that he's of the priestly family. That means we should have our ears attuned to whenever he talks about corrupt worship practices or about things going on among the priesthood that needs to change. Because if Zechariah is an insider and he's critiquing his own people, if you will, then we have to be careful and pay attention to those critiques, because it often is very significant. And in fact, as we go through the book, we'll see that Zechariah has a lot to say about the priestly line, particularly in chapter 3, where he has this vision about Joshua, the high priest, who has these filthy robes. And so Zechariah is kind of critiquing his own family in a certain sense, if you will, as a priest. All right, so it's significant that a priestly prophet comes. In Zechariah, we see the merging here of priest, king, and prophet. And I want us to remember that because it becomes very important, particularly in chapter 6. When we get to chapter 6 and Zechariah has this vision about a future Messiah, he's going to say that he'll be priest and king, and they'll sit on their thrones and have counsel together. If you're familiar with what's called the Qumran community, this is where the Dead Sea Scrolls were discovered in 1947 in the Judean wilderness by the Dead Sea. When they interpreted that particular prophecy in verses like that, they came to believe that there must be two messiahs coming. How could one messiah fulfill both of those roles? And so this became, in some segments of the society, a common perception. But of course, we know that all of this is pointing to Christ, and when we understand how they converge in the person of Christ, it begins to make sense of the whole picture of how God planned this for a priest and a king to be together. And even our message this morning emphasized that, that John the Apostle says what? That God has made you to be a kingdom, priests to God. And that's a quote from Exodus 19:6, which says, God is making Israel a kingdom of priests. That's unusual, because normally the priests don't interfere with the king, and supposedly it's not supposed to be vice versa either. In other words, these are two distinct realms. But here they're merged. So the king and the priest come together. And that's the case here in Zechariah as well, as we'll see. Okay, that's enough of that. So Zechariah is from the priestly line. He comes, and he gives this formula here that the word of the Lord comes to him. All right, so again, if we're imagining ourselves there, and we hear this, that the word of the Lord has come to the prophet Zechariah, what should our response be? Right, this is a very solemn formula. What it's suggesting here is that God is personally giving a message to the prophet that is to be relayed now to his people. This phrase, the word of the Lord came to so-and-so, is very common and popular in the prophetic literature. In fact, it's found 150 times. And so it really stresses the fact that there's a personal nature to what's being said. It's the word of the Lord, and it's come now to Zechariah. All right, so that's verse 1, and then we begin verse 2. What is the message? Now, the first word in the Hebrew text of verse 2 is anger. Okay, I've translated the Lord as was very furious or something along those lines. The idea is God was angry. So Zechariah does not begin his message by saying, God loves you and has a plan for your life. Right? He's not quoting Jeremiah 29:11 in his first message. He begins with the word anger. Now, what response would you have if this prophet from the priestly families come and the first word he said is angry, the Lord. The Lord is angry with you. What's that going to make? What sort of reaction might that conjure up, do you think, Anthony?
Fear and trembling.
Okay, fear and trembling. Why? Why would there be fear and trembling?
It just came from exile because the Lord was angry. And now the Lord is angry. And, well, they're in a very tenuous situation. They just came out. I think they'd have a feel of, oh no, we're going to go back. Mm-hmm. Or remember where we just came from. The Lord was angry. That kind of feeling, judgment.
Right, right. It's like when I was young, I'll expose all my faults, but when I got spanked, you know, there was a certain reverence, at least for a little while, that I would exhibit toward my parents and my mom in particular, and she would just have to say, do I need to get the spoon? And that would calm me down, that, hey, I need to get back on track here. Well, this is kind of what Zechariah is saying. He's coming and saying, the Lord has been angry. And particularly here in verse 2, to whom is the anger targeted? He's been angry with your fathers, your forefathers, but the implication is he's also not pleased with you, because he wouldn't go to the trouble of sending a prophet to tell you he was angry with his fathers if there wasn't some implication that you need to get your act together. So he comes and he says the Lord was angry. Now the beauty of this is if we turn to the book of Malachi, and that's the last of the prophets in this post-exilic period. The very first word that God says there is love. Okay, so it's not that this was just such a dark period of time that God had forgotten his love for his people. That's not at all the case. In fact, we see the fury of Zechariah to be compared and contrasted with the love of Malachi. But it is meant to shake them a little bit and to get them to think, do you need to, again, repent? Do you need to think about what you're doing? Because the Lord's been angry. So don't keep this up. He's been angry. All right, and so then he goes on in verse 2 here and then verse 3 to describe how that historically has been the case. Let me just, one other thing to mention before. The anger of the Lord is a theme that is revisited several other times in Zechariah, so you can just jot this down. But in chapter 1, verse 15, again, he talks about his anger, and in 7:12, he talks about his anger. And so if there's one thing we can get from this little section, it's this, that the Lord is displeased and angry with sin, and there comes a day when it will be punished.
Okay, we live in a day and age in which most people give very fleeting thoughts, if at all, to God. But God is clear, and he's outlined in Scripture that all sin will be judged, either by Christ vicariously or in condemnation apart from God. Sin will be judged. And so it's appropriate for that first message to be anger if it wakes us up from our sin. Is it loving to talk about hell, for instance? You know, I'm teaching a course in a local high school, and our first book that we've been going over is Dante Inferno. And Dante has this vision of nine regions of hell. And so with ninth graders, we're working through what is hell like as Dante imagines it versus what is it like as the Bible portrays it. And there's a bit of discomfort with that, right? Naturally, it's like, this is a very dark topic. But as I read through the Gospels, I find Jesus again and again and again going back to hell. Why does he do that? The only thing that sinks into my mind is, if we never talk about this, we don't really love people. If that's true, we should be talking about it if we love people. It's not thinking that it's true and not loving people that would cause us to avoid it. So all that to say, sometimes the words are very sober, and that's the case here. All right, so the Lord is angry, and in verse 3, he goes on and he says, this is how you then apply it. So therefore say to them, thus declares the Lord of hosts, turn back to me, says the Lord of hosts, and I will turn back to you, says the Lord of hosts. All right, let's talk about this verse. What sticks out to you about verse 3 here? What phrases are repeated as you look through that verse? Okay, the Lord of hosts, I heard. Okay, and return to me. So the two, I think, key phrases of verse 3 and 4 are those, the idea of turning back and the idea of the Lord of hosts. All right, so let's talk about them in turn. This idea of turning back. This is the word that often is translated repent. It's a word in Hebrew that means to return or to turn back from a certain way of living or a certain path. And so the Lord here is saying, you need to turn back to me. And it's rooted in covenant language. You'll remember that when the prophets come on the scene, we might describe them as the covenant enforcers. They come to tell the people, you have violated the covenant. God is sending you a message. This is a warning. It's a verbal. You need to get back and get right with God, to turn back. And so this is a key word, and Zechariah here is picking up a word that's proliferated through the prophets about repentance, turning back to God. Okay, so if we tuck that in our mind with the previous verse, if God is angry and now he's saying turn back, this is a wake-up call. I need to be listening to what God is saying. So he says turn back, return. If we had a little bit more time, we could go back to 2 Kings 17. And there, when the northern kingdom falls, the prophets give an extended explanation for why they fell. And they basically say it was because of their sin, because of their idolatry, and because they refused to turn back to God. And so this is a warning that we need. We need to be reminded to continually turn back to God. Martin Luther, the famous Reformation theologian, said, "The life of the believer should be one of perpetual repentance." That is, at every moment, we're repenting in a certain way. In other words, our whole life is lived in a posture of repentance, because if we understand our own sin, how else can we live but repenting continually before the Lord? All right, so that's one. And then secondly, he uses this phrase, and it seems almost repetitive to us, to the point of tedium. He says three times here in verse 3, the Lord of hosts. So what does that mean? What does the Lord of hosts mean? Speaking of Martin Luther, if you're familiar with A Mighty Fortress Is Our God, a famous hymn that Martin Luther wrote, he has a phrase in there, Lord Sabaoth, his name. You remember that phrase? And this is the Hebrew, Lord Sabaoth is of hosts, if you will. We could translate it that way. And so this is a common phrase for the Lord, and particularly it's common in these three post-exilic prophets.
It's used, let me just give you the stats, 267 times in the Old Testament and 91 times, or about a third, just in the books of Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. So about a third of the whole usage of this phrase in the Old Testament is found in these three books. And it means something along the line of the Lord of multitudinous armies, the Lord of royal majesty, of regal dominion. It came to essentially mean God who has kingly authority, power, and sovereignty. Now, why would Zechariah say this title of the Lord over and over again? He needs to only probably say it once, and we got it, but he says it three times. Why does he do that? Any thoughts, Anthony?
It's a very in-your-face reminder to these people that, hey, this message is coming from Almighty God. He is the Lord of hosts. Do you understand that this message is coming from the person who is the commander of the armies, the king of kings, the Almighty God? He will lay waste to your people, basically. You've seen in what has happened to you before. You were in exile. That's not the worst that could happen to you if you don't listen. So
right.
you better get the picture.
Okay. Basically. Right. Yeah, good. Tina?
They've been conquered. They've been taken into exile. They feel weak. And in a sense, do you fear Babylon? Do you fear the army, or do you fear the Lord?
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Good. There's this sense in which Scripture and the Lord continue to remind us that all appearances are not reality. And what I mean by that is there's no king on the throne when Zechariah comes on the scene. There's no royal Judean kingdom. They've been exiled. They don't have a monarch reigning. But when the Lord comes, he's reminding them, hey, I am sovereign over the nations. I don't need a king on the throne to execute my plan. I am sovereign, and I will bring it to pass. And so this is an encouragement to the people who live in very meager circumstances and a very tough economic situation, and they seem scattered. There's no cohesion. They don't know who's going to lead. There's a lot of corruption. So who's talking to them? It's the sovereign God, the sovereign Almighty Lord. He's come and he's brought a message. All right, so our time has slipped away, so let me just summarize here these last several verses. He basically reminds them that even though their fathers have passed off the scene, his word is still true. His word is still supreme. And we find this throughout Scripture. Isaiah 48 says, "The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever." Psalm 119:89 says, "Forever, O Lord, your word is firmly fixed in the heavens." So the point here is, your mortal, temporary, transitory, you're passing away, you will soon die. And isn't that the case? That's a somber thought, but all of us, not many years from now, will have passed the scene and there will be few to even remember us. But God's word is fixed. It will stand. So what that should do for us is force us to reorient our thinking. If we're caught up with the things that don't last, what good is it? If we're so caught up with the things that 30, 40, 50 years from now, there will scarcely be a person on earth who even remembers it or knows anything about it. If we're caught up worrying about those things, our priorities are in the wrong place. And so Zechariah wants to remind them, God's word will stand forever. So let me just go through, just touch on these application principles, and then we'll close. So what should we do? I think as a result of that, we need to guard against our own tendency to have a hard heart. I continue to experience this sometimes in my own life, and I think, I've been a Christian long enough, I should have gotten this by now, but I still have a cold heart sometimes, a hard heart. And I think probably if we're truthful, many of us could admit to that, and so we need to check ourselves. Are we receptive to the Word of God? And then, re-examine our priorities. What are we placing our lives, gathering our lives around, or structuring our lives around? We need to re-examine our priorities. And then to wait on the Lord. He will accomplish His plan. And this is what the forefathers, as Zechariah portrays them, as the Lord portrays them, they realize at the end of verse 6, they finally repented and they said, "As the Lord of hosts purposed to deal with us, so He has done. And they came to the point where they realized that, unfortunately, it was too late. They had already been put into exile, but they eventually realized, yes, the Lord is sovereign. So we can save ourselves a lot of pain, if you will, if we acknowledge God's word is supreme. He will accomplish his plan. All right, well, that's, in a nutshell, Zechariah 1, 1-6. Any final thoughts or questions or comments about this text?
I mean, I'm just struck by reading this through, and I think everyone else's comments kind of pointed me in that direction, but it strikes me as how sometimes I treat God like a Coke machine. Mm-hmm. You want God to give you good things, and you hear good and grace, and that's good, but why would I fear that? I fear that God is in control and can do these things. And they knew that because of what was just said. So to me, it carries weight for me to worship a God that I can fear, that has control, that his duty is to punish sin and to send those people that are sinning to hell ultimately. But he gave us this Christ to absorb that wrath. So I'm reading that. That's what struck me. I don't know if anyone else thought about that, but.
Yeah, no, that's good. It is. It's a sober reminder. We do treat God like a vending machine, like a moral therapist, if you will, who just wants the best for us and all of that, a life coach. But there's much more to it than that, obviously. All right, good. Any other thoughts? Pam?
I was just thinking, is it not a mercy that he would be furious with us so
dead time? Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's what the book of Hebrews says, right? That he, if we are true sons, he will discipline us, chastise us, to show that we are legitimate.
I wonder sometimes why, what is it, Jonathan Edwards, why people caught in the hands of an angry God will not preach in America anymore?
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, we live in, you know, as we've said, we live in a day in which there's little tolerance for bad news or for confrontation. And so we do want to see God as one of the guys. We have a backslapping familiarity with God. We want him just to be our therapist and life coach. And I think about this a lot because, you know, we'll be told that it's not loving if we talk about sin. But you know, if I have children who want to play in the street, is it not loving for me to yank them out of the street if I know a car is coming, or is it more loving just not to confront them? Obviously, I mean, we know what the answer is, and how we live our lives is often opposed to our way of thinking sometimes. But yeah, we do live in this age where there's low tolerance for that. So again, it's good to be reminded of the truth, the sobering reality of Scripture. All right, so let's close in a word of prayer. Thank you for your patience this morning. Father, we thank you for this word, and although our time and we feel like we just really skimmed the surface of some of the things here going on, we just thank you for this reminder that your mercy is evident even in the midst of wrath. As the prophet said, in wrath, remember mercy. And Lord, we pray that we too would realize that sin is no trifling thing. And I pray that you would help us to repent, to turn back to you if there are areas in our lives that we need to turn back, that we would not be hardened, that as the writer of Hebrews says, that today if we will hear your voice, that we not be hardened as they were in the rebellion, that there be no bitter root of sin that would defile us. And so, Lord, I pray that you would help us to turn to you, and I ask that you would grant grace, mercy, and peace to all those here. We thank you for this fellowship we have, this community of believers here, and I just pray that we would encourage and strengthen one another, and I pray that our fellowship now would be sweet, and as we go through the rest of this week, that we would be walking with you humbly, and full of grace and mercy. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.